the importance of PKI for business and society on the whole is that it's a versatile technology. It supports an extremely broad set of use cases that address a multitude of business challenges. You know, we're all looking for integrity, authenticity, and information protection, as well as providing as frictionless user experience as possible. Good examples of where PKI is used in businesses or in society are really commonplace, and you tend to forget that you're doing PKI, or it's when done well, you should be completely oblivious. So things like accessing corporate networks from mobile, tablet or laptop devices, dialing into, connecting to, VPNing into your corporate network when you're conducting electronic commerce. I think so many of us forget that when you're, you know, banking online, transacting online, PKI is being used to secure your personal information that's being transmitted to your online retailer or your online bank, as an example. Document signing is another first-class example of using keys, certificates, and PKI to secure the integrity or authenticity of a particular document. You tend to think about using PKI in a enterprise setting or electronic commerce setting. The usage of PKI goes far beyond that when you start looking at the national level. So there are a lot of very mature e-government initiatives across the European Union and out into the rest of the world. So people that have a national identity card, a polycarbonate piece of plastic that goes into your wallet, may most cases have a chip on it and that you'd have a PIN associated, but inside that credential would be, you know, private keys that can be used for you to access secure government resources. So maybe you're viewing your healthcare information online, you're signing tax return, you're accessing some form of electronic government portal app will be all underpinned by a high trust infrastructure managed at the national level that enables many citizens to access government resources, as well as when you're traveling. You know, your most second generation or first or second generation, I should say, passports have a little indicator on the front of the booklet that indicate there's a chip inside. And when you're, you know, crossing the border, you're passing your travel document to the border agent, and whilst he's validating you are who you say you are, asking you lots of questions as to why you're on your travels, all of the information on your passport has been digitally signed. So any fraudulent travel documents or fake travel documents can or should be identified, as well as securing biometric information that may or may not have been written to the passport. Governments want to secure who has access to that whilst the document's being read, and all of this requires PKI. I think PKI was actually years ahead of its time, and I think it's worth remembering some of the key business challenges that PKI helps to address. It's all about, you know, authenticating people, devices, and things. And back in the early 2000s, SaaS providers, they didn't exist. And so all of the applications that an enterprise delivered, all of the security was provided by the enterprise. You know, applications were delivered by the IT team from inside the corporate network. You know, all users went to work, they worked from a fixed desk, they had a dedicated fixed PC that was often connected to the corporate network via an Ethernet cable. And any remote users that you may have would have been at home connecting in over a VPN using two-factor authentication using a 56K modem. The world today is extremely different, and now most of the users are remote, they're on the road, they work from home. You know, they leverage a mixture of in-house and cloud-based applications and or infrastructure. So your user now is sourcing the applications from cloud providers, they're putting information into a variety of different SaaS-based platforms. The IT challenge here is providing credentials and security to the user accessing these providers and the sensitive information that's being put up into the cloud. And so I don't think the importance of PKI didn't go away. The ability to leverage PKI by an enterprise wasn't actually there until today. When you look at how significantly the world has changed, you need to establish trust between all these providers. You need to securely authenticate your users to all these providers from a centralized trust infrastructure. And so I think technology has really caught PKI up. Is it difficult to build your own PKI? Well, I think people often overlook the fact that PKI is a mixture of roles, policies, hardware, software, and procedures. And these are all key ingredients are all needed to create, manage, distribute, use, store, and revoke digital certificates. And when you take a step back and look at it in reality, a PKI is probably 20, at the max 30% technology, and 70 to 80% policy and procedure. You know, installing technology is a relatively easy exercise, which is why so many organizations that I've dealt with over the years have often ended up with a very difficult certificate management problem. You know, installing CAs on a project basis, going to a variety of providers, sometimes even generating self-signed certificates for individual projects is kind of where some organizations have fallen foul of the fact that technology is a very easy thing to install. We can all hit next without thinking. Install a particular piece of technology. And I'm not suggesting for a moment that every PKI out there has been installed in such a haphazard way, but the very nature of the way organizations have evolved over the years have meant that, you know, there hasn't been a centralized certificate and or crypto function. And so the necessity to provide keys and certificates to address a particular project has been required. So, you know, people have gone to the market, they've looked at open source tools, they've, you know, used applications that have been built into the operating system to deliver the all-important, you know, air quotes, certificate function. But building a centralized trust infrastructure that's built to best practice, built to a standardized policy, you know, can require some specialist technology. You know, you would use hardware security module to protect your critical keys. That can require some specialist knowledge. There's the software that's used to form the PKI, you know, the certification authority, how you offer revocation information, how you enroll users, maybe how you apply digital signatures as an example. You know, these are all can be vendor specific, but vendors do offer comprehensive documentation. There's, you know, serious amounts of training that all of these vendors provide. And because PKI is underpinned by standards, like from the likes of International Civil Aviation Organization, NIST, ETSI, the CA Browser Forum, and all of these provide guidance on how a PKI should be designed and built to address a certain set of requirements. People then have to analyze when and if they need public trust, or if they need private trust, or if they need both, which particular framework are they looking to build their PKI to. But PKI skills in the industry can be hard to find if you're looking to deploy your own to any of the previously mentioned schemes or requirements. And so, you know, you can look to trust service providers to operate and build your PKI or digital signing service or whatever trust offering you need. You know, that can and often is the requirement. You know, smaller organizations, medium-sized organizations won't necessarily have the required skills or personnel in-house to be able to roll out a PKI that's built to operational best practice and procedures. So they would, you know, naturally defer to and go to a service provider. But you must also acknowledge that organizations out there instantly think of government that couldn't use a cloud-based provider, and so they would have some form of internal skill set or internal skill pool to call from to run, build, and operate these services. PKI does need to evolve, and it does need to change with the rest of the technology space that it sits in. It'll need to keep pace like any other vendors to provide things like new enrollment protocols. If you think about and look at PKI, things like SCEP and CMP, they've been around for an awful long time. And in some cases, showing their age and have been deprecated and or replaced or updated. Some of the newer kids on the block with regards to, you know, certificate enrollment from an application or a device perspective would be EST or ACME, two of the newcomers that PKI software and or providers need to adopt for, you know, supporting different and new use cases. Being able to support new algorithms, new key sizes, etc., you know, quantum resistant algorithms is a very important topic that's on the agenda for most PKI vendors and most serious security organizations. You know, there needs to be the ability to address quantum resistance within the trust infrastructure in the years ahead. And I think as some of the PKI deployments or large IT schemes roll out, when you look at national schemes, national ID, 5G telecommunications network, these are vast sprawling networks that have many, many moving components and have very far reach in terms of who it is that you're going to need to offer security services for. So offering the appropriate availability requirements, deployment capability for PKI, you know, scaling elastically your ability to issue certificates, being able to offer an appropriate number of nines for your availability of revocation information will become quite critical as these big sprawling deployments grow. threat's quite a strong word, but I think it does play neatly into why you would use PKI. It's there for authenticity, integrity, and information protection. And so as technology advances around any given system, it too needs to evolve. So as I've already spoken about, the threat of quantum on a given algorithm and or key size, that's been widely acknowledged for a good number of years now. And there's advancements being made to build quantum resistant algorithms that should be made part of any given PKI. So I think on the short term radar, or medium to short term, because I think timescales are as far away as 2030, which is 10 years, but 10 years can go in a very quick time. So, you know, in between now and 2030, vendors need to be striving towards quantum resistance within a given trust infrastructure. And, you know, there's lots of schemes that are running currently to produce and select the appropriate algorithms that vendors will need to make available. When you set quantum aside, I think you definitely need to look at some of the challenges that organizations will have encountered over the last 10 to 20 years for their PKI deployments. I've stated, and others have stated, that it is very easy to deploy a PKI badly. The whole next finished, where you've not put much thought into the policy, the framework that your PKI is operating to. So, you know, definitely organizations will see issues with poorly designed or poorly deployed PKIs, where a weak algorithm or a small key size may have been used, or an inadequate enrollment policy. Along a similar vein, deployments where no hardware protection has been used for critical keys, so root CAs, issuing CAs, you know, best practice says that you should use some form of hardware-based security module for the generation and long-term storage of those keys. User keys and certificates that are being used for signature and non-repudiation, you know, if they're not protected by strong PIN or password, they almost certainly should be protected by some form of hardware device. So a cryptographic smart card, if you're dealing with local signatures, or if it's cloud-based signatures, having a hardware security module on your back-end services, you know, that, you know, if you haven't done that, then for sure you could conceivably raise eyebrows over, you know, was the individual in sole control of the key when it was being used. And as, you know, the technology landscape evolves, adopting new requirements to support evolving use cases. So that could be something along the lines of new types of certificates and new extensions, support for centralized certificate lifecycle management, not just for a given technology or a given vendor, but across a variety of vendors, you know, promoting interoperability for any trust infrastructure that's within a given enterprise, support for interoperable protocols. If you're looking at digital signature, ensuring that you can interoperate with not just the back-end certification authorities you have out there, but the signing applications you're using in the front-end. So things like cloud signature consortium start to become important there when you're looking at ensuring interoperability across the playing field. I've already mentioned, but I'll certainly mention it again, as things evolve, looking at support for new and evolving enrollment protocols. Two newest that have come or been created in the last 5 years will be EST and ACME, and really important for any PKI, and I guess when you think about threat in particular, is you're issuing keys and certificates to people, devices and things. And so your vetting and enrollment procedures need to be very robust in order to ensure that, you know, the individual who's trying to enroll for a credential meets all of the business requirements that are laid out in your security certificate policy. So, you know, any key that's introduced into the system that's underpinned by a weak enrollment process can fundamentally compromise the integrity of the credential, which would then lead to a weak signature being applied or granting somebody access to a network where they've impersonated somebody. Having a weak or a not very robust registration process, I see as being another threat.